disciplined person chooses a goal, sets out to do it, and doesn't waver despite all the temptations and distractions that may lure him or her off the true path. If we want to lose weight, discipline means having the willpower to stick to a diet. If we want to run a marathon, discipline may mean getting up very early in the morning to put in your mileage. If we want a promotion, discipline may mean working late into the evening or on weekends rather than spending that time with friends or family. If we want a new car, discipline may mean foregoing some other must-have purchases in each of these cases. The exercise of discipline leads to a clear, tangible reward. A thinner, fitter you, a better job, a fancier car in your driveway. The words world champion after your name. Yeah.
When Phil opened the gym, he was one of the first lads to walk through the door, wasn't he, Maurice? So, you know, he was 1981 when he first opened the doors. What do you remember of that time, and when did you first get into the champs camp and meet Phil?
Me and my friend Steve Lugber said that we'd go to Agent. It don't have to be a boxing gym, just Agent to train. You know, because when you're 15, 16, you're messing around and just feel like training. So we went to the gym, which was on Clement Road then at the time, and it just happened to be a boxing gym. So we went in there, and I run off. Because I had a cigarette in my mouth and
that's true, you did have a cigarette in your mouth.
Yeah, a cigarette in my mouth, yes. I run off and I come back. Steve stayed and I come back about 3 months later. And then took it from there. Yeah, we started training. Our friends were in the gym. And I thought, I can do that, what they're doing. And before you know it, you're having your first fight. And that's the start of your career, you know.
How would boxing, you know, took over your life? What was you doing prior to it?
Well, I went to a sports school, right, Robinson College. I went there, and it was always geared around sports. So lucky for me, I was always involved in sports. When I left school, I went to play basketball. And, you know, but when you get to that age, you're thinking, I want to mess around on the street with the boys, you know what I mean, do the stuff. And you start, you know, getting introduced to girls and everything else. So that's what happened with me. And then, after a while, you start feeling guilty for not being in the gym. So that's why I ended up going to the gym, which happened to be the boxing gym. I remember the first time I seen Phil, I was a bit like that about him, because he looked tough. He looked like he weren't messing around at all, you know what I mean? He looked like he's serious. And I didn't really come across anyone in my life yet. but it's a challenge anyway, and I was glad to take it on. And that's what happened, you know, because when the guys were in there training, and I thought, I can do that better than that. And I kept saying to myself, I can do it better. And I remember it took 5 weeks to stop the cigarette. And I did look back and, yeah, it was great ever since then. I just thought, you know, so onwards and upwards.
As a person, that you've always had a determination, desire in yourself, and, you know, you could push yourself, and did that, you know, go over into your boxing training, and the discipline side of things?
Yeah, I think it's because I went to the sports school. My parents sent to that school, and it was more concentrated and geared around sports. And because of that's your upbringing, that's all you know. You know, you're going to go back into that at some point or another. And I did. And because it could have been any gym that I walked into. You know, I would have, you know, done it the best I could, you know. I would have trained the best I could. But it happened to be a boxing gym. And but it wasn't like I was, you know, 8, 9, 10 years old, like you hear some guy saying and dream about being a world champion and things like that. Boxing was in my mind. You know, the only thing I knew was Muhammad Ali at the time, where everyone else knew. That was it. I wasn't interested in boxing. And then this is what happened.
You started an amateur career under Phil, and you know, you got your medical, and you had 60-odd fights you had as an amateur, didn't you?
Yeah.
So what do you remember of your amateur career, and, you know, did it set you up well for the pros?
Yeah, because Phil, you know, he always put us in fights where, you know, they would give us some kind of, make us grow, you know, and give us more experience, because the kids we were fighting had more experience than us. And at the time, the amateurs couldn't really believe how we've only had 3-4 fights, and we're beating kids that box for England, and not just beating them, knocking them out as well. So we gained a quick reputation in the amateurs. And obviously, when you're in a camp where, you know, your gym's successful, you know, success breeds success. So
Phil was very advanced, wasn't he, in his coaching methods and almost training you all as professionals, even when you was in the amateur game. Mm. What did he give you as a boxer?
Well, he gave us all his experience, and we used to have a guy in there who was British champion called Eddie Smith, and he was training on a regular. Now, Eddie was like the Grim Reaper, also was, because we were amateurs and he was professional. Not only professional, he was British champion at the time. I think he just beat Tony Simpson. Anyway, and Tony Simpson was a tough man. So we were sparring with Eddie, and every time we sparred with Eddie, it was horrible, you know, because we used to hate it, and at the time we had a ring there, probably 10-foot by 10-foot ring there in the corner, and he couldn't run, you know, so he had to fight it. And it was horrible, really, but it gives you a lot of experience. And, you know, one thing you find out one week after another, you're learning things, Eddie would teach you things. I've got a big amount of respect for Eddie Smith, because none of us won't be anywhere. Eddie was a dangerous boy, dangerous guy at the time. He was like, he'd just be there, you know, he wouldn't mess around. He knew that if you spar with Eddie the next day, he'd make sure you go to bed, he'd make sure you eat, he'd make sure you sleep, make sure everything was possibly right as it could be, you know. Because it was a nightmare to spar with him, to tell the truth. After a while, he started feeling more comfortable, but after a few years, he did. You know what I mean? But until then, it was an uphill struggle.
You've said in the past that under Phil, you always had a plan, or Phil had a plan for you, you know, throughout, obviously, your amateur career. Was that plan always to turn pro and to become a champion?
Yeah, well, Phil's plan was to... I was all amateurs, and he was going to turn pro with him. At the time, people were turning pro with the big boys, you know, the Frank Warren, Mickey Dufton kind of people. And they were seen to be only promoters that round. So it's going to be a hard struggle for Phil to turn us all pro, you know, because then we're getting paid as well. And you've got the overheads with the show fees, you know, the venue, you know, the doctors, the referees, everything, they all start adding up. And Phil went into partnership with a man called Harry Garty, who just recently passed away. And them two promoted us when we turned professional.
You did turn pro in January 1990. What do you remember about, you know, getting rid of the vest that first night? The surprise and the, you know, the realisation that you was now a professional fighter.
Well, I remember I always got to the ABA finals. At them times, the ABAs were the whole region, not just the Northwest. You know, they got to the ABA finals once, and I got beat in the finals, and I was upset bad with that. I got to the semi-finals and the quarter-finals, and also Phil said, that's it now, we're turning pro. And one day he called me and said to me, there's a fight at the Midland Hotel, exhibition, professional. He said, do you want it? I said, of course, boy. He told me what I was getting, £250. But £250 to me was like 250,000. I'd rather that than a trophy, you know? Anyway, so I went to, it's funny, you know, went to my mum. I said to my mum, I'm turning pro. And she said, no, you're not. You're not turning professional. No, you're not turning professional. I said, yeah, I am. She goes, no, you're not, and all that kind of thing. Anyway, so Phil said there's a fight there in Bingham Hotel exhibition. Went down there, and this kid, he says, right, no knockouts, you know, don't hurt the kid, or you don't hurt you. So I said, forget that, you know what I mean, because that's not the way we've been brought up, you know what I mean, with Phil. So I said, I'm going to go out there and deal with him. Anyway, so we went out there as an exhibition fight. Anyway, put him down, and the referee went crazy, boy, went crazy. He said, you're not supposed to be doing that, you know what I mean? And he cut the fight short, and that was that. Anyway, he got paid £250. So I went on to my mum and I said, I've turned pro. And the fight, she's going mad. And I give her £100. And she went, oh, it's not too bad this. So that was the start of that. She started out, everyone started, I'm up, you know what I mean? And that was that, turned pro.
In your third fight, you fought Nicky Piper, yep. Who was to go on and challenge for a world title and then the British champion. He turned out to be a quality fight. It was a good matchup for you in your third fight. I think he was in his fourth or fifth or something, both unbeaten. It turned out to be a great fight as well, if I remember rightly.
Yeah, it was. I got told what happened with first of all, tell us to be right and ready, you know, because you're not ABA champion five times, you're not going to get the phone call where you're going to get, you know, 10 weeks notice, you're the opponent, so we always need to be ready, and we also need to train like we're fighting the next night. And the next morning, one morning I went running and Phil came to my house and said, the fight's on tonight, they won it. So they were against it, Nicky Piper. I said, yeah, I never heard of Nicky Piper. So I thought, I love it. He's a way of Wales. God, if he says so, I said, okay. So night time he came for me, we went down to Wales, and I was ready, I weighed in, he weighed in. And then the first time in my life I've seen so much TV cameras, and Byron McGugan and everybody else around, and it's all over, you find Nicky Piper, and I'm thinking, why are they making a fuss of this guy? Anyway, I found out in the first round why they're making a fuss of this guy. Boom, put me down in the first punch of the first round, put me down, and I got up and I thought, this is professional. Anyway, I got up and lasted a round, come back the second round, boom, he caught me again, I left hook and I thought, geez, it's going to be a hard night tonight. Put me down again.
Yeah, that's a lovely left kick by Piper to the body.
He said in the fourth round that Piper's got the power to break Core apart, and that was a tremendous flurry. Is he going to beat the count? He's up at 8. Second time he's been down, and ref just found. French's referee in there is doing a very tidy job so far. First box on. Very impressive work though from Piper. And now just looking at him and the concentration on his face. He's got one thing on his mind. He wants to finish this one again in the second round. Good body shots coming in as well. He's so controlled in his work. Piper, when he gets a man going, there's another good shot and the gum shield is out. And will it finish here in the second? Maurice Core's done well in this round. You've got to remember he fought most of it without his gum shield.
Anyway, so like I said to you before, Phil, I got me to the corner, Phil said, listen, quite frankly, he said, fuck this lot here. You know what I mean? Get on with it. He told me what to do. And the things I remember straight away. And when he said that, you know, like, you know, relaxed. I just relaxed a bit. And then basically, I give Nicky Piper a boxing lesson after that. Can't with everything, you know what I mean?
That knockdown might just have been a bit of a flash knockdown. And Core proved himself, I would think, his best opponent to date.
Definitely a tough test this early on in his career. But, you know, this is, as I say, I hate repeating myself, but this is the stage where it starts to mend for the boys. And,
a good trainer, Nicky Piper. Fellow is down at Culver House Cross, right opposite the HTV studios, on the outskirts of Cardiff. One all four on knockout. He had Maurice Core down in literally the first few seconds. Had him down again in the second round. It's a good shot from Core coming in. But the 21-year-old from Manchester has proved to be Nicky Piper's slipperiest and best opponent to date.
And the fight ended up to be a draw. And to me, even though he put me down twice, I think that's a win for me, because if I'm going to a man's backyard, he's the favourite. He's a man who's looking at. And I get a draw with him in his backyard and he's put me down twice. That's a win. Anyway, he went on since then, but since that fight then, that's what established me in the professional rank. You always need a fight to establish you, and that's the one that established me.
It really showed you steel and your mettle, didn't it, to get knocked down and then come back and to outbox him to get the draw. And you know,
I mean, he said he wants to fight again. I said I want to fight again. You know, so we said we'll fight later on down the line. When he's got something to go for, and I have as well. It'd be a good fight, you know, it'd be a good fight. We could punch, I'll give him that.
Surprised at that. Well, the only surprise it was is that I got the fight at 2 days' notice. I wasn't sharp, you know. I took the fight. It's my second fight. So, you know, you eventually have to move up and fight these guys. So, opportunity comes, so I fought again. you know.
You're down on the deck twice, though, and you still got a draw.
Yeah, he did catch me. He did catch me. But like I say, I wasn't sharp. You know, I only found out 2 days ago, and, you know, you take the fight, innit? You know, you have to move up.
Did you honestly feel that you had done enough to draw, though?
Yeah, I thought I'd done enough to draw, you know, because I didn't feel threatened by any time. Only when they put me down, though, because they didn't even follow it up like most boxers would, you know. Still knew where I was. I stayed down until 7. I got up, you know, looked at the manager, I was okay. He put me down with some sharp punches, so.
Well, Nicky thinks he should have won. Yeah. Would you be happy to go through it all again?
I would. Very happy. You know, with a bit of notice, though, this time. You know?
I think it's a couple of years later. Carl Thompson got a call, you know about that, right? Carl Thompson got the same thing, same phone call. What to do, they call you late. Because I was talking to Nicky about it. Nicky said that he trained for me for 8 weeks. That's how long he knew that he's fighting me. And I said, I ain't found out on the night. And he says, right. And Carl Thompson would try the same thing with him. Phil turned around, because Phil was a master. And Phil turned around and said, well, he might have to up his money a bit because he's just come back from holiday. I'll see if I can get him down, you know what I mean? He might be a little bit heavy. But like I said to you before, we're training in the gym, training all the time, 100% right all the time. So Phil told him, he said, we'll fight tomorrow night. He said, right, okay. So Carl went down there. And Carl absolutely, you see the fight? Carl smashed him up all over the place. Smashed him up. Worse than what I done to him, you know, smashed him up and stopped him, yeah. Yeah, it's a good one. Well done, Carl.
You started to learn what the pros was all about then, and you know, the way it all works. And
yeah, I mean, they're always trying to get one over you, you know. I remember in the amateurs when Ensley was fighting when England kid, pictures out there, Ted Kershaw, and Phil went in there, he must have heard that in the interview, Phil went out there and weighed on a scale, but Phil put like a big weight on him to make him weigh heavy, because they were scared of Ensley. So Phil got on the scale, Ensley, and he said, he's overweight, so his trainer's coming, he's overweight, he's not making the weight, dead happy. You know, Phil said, I'm going to say, I'm just going to the toilet and try something. So we're in the toilet, so he took the weight off him. So he's gone like that, he said to Ensley, one of the guys, pass me that wire or something else like that, you know, something stupid. He says, come back out, and now jumped on the scale, Ensley. And he's bang gone. So his trainer's going crazy now. He's cheating, he's this, he's that. And Ensley went, he's just all mind games. And then Ensley went out there and beat the crap out of the boy. Beat him, but they could never give it to him, you know what I mean? Put him down, wobbled him, everything, you know what I mean?
It was great.
Because we always had to fight against. Just going back to amateurs briefly. I mean, I was number one in England for nearly 2 years. And the reason why I stayed amateur is to go to the Olympics. And I kept going to all the Northwest, all the England training, all that kind of thing. And then they turned around after that 18 months and said, we're not going to pick you. You know, they picked 3 kids to go to the Olympics that year. And said they're not going to pick me because I haven't got no experience. So Phil's argument was, well, how do you get experience if you're not picking him? So that's mad enough then. I said, right, we'll just go pro. And that's it.
Everyone always knew that when any of the champs camps lads were on a bill, you know, the opponent was in for a tough night. Phil had really built up that, you know, aura of instant invincibility, but a real aura of strength from this gym, wasn't it?
Yeah.
He's carried that into the ring. Just...
Yeah, people knew that, you know, if you fight anyone from the gym, you're going to be in shape, you know, and that's it, you know. So you know that if you're not in shape, you know, you've got a tough fight going on.
After that Nicky Piper fight, 8 fights later, you became British champion.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a bit of a whirlwind into your professional career. Noel Magee, you stopped him in the 9th round, 1992. What do you remember of British champion? It was amazing, wasn't it?
Yeah, the championship is fine, but the fight weren't the best, you know. It's more nerves, because at the time, I had a lot of things going on with them. At the time, I mean, Paul Burke won his. We had champions at the time. Then Frank Grant, he was fighting the week before, and he fought Earl Graham, who he wasn't supposed to beat, and he stopped him. And then everyone expected me to win, you know, not even half a challenge, and so. But it's more nerves than anything that got me. I was just eager. So anyway, I stopped him. Yeah, I stopped him in the 9th round, and it was a good stoppage. technical stuff is yet.
And again, good stop there from Core. Well, this one just might be slipping away from Magee in the middle round. This is round 9. There's 3 more after. Oh, and again, lovely left right from Core. Finishes off with a couple of left hooks and another right. Well, this could be the most conclusive round of the fight for Maurice Core so far. And Noel Magee, desperate now for some success. He's been rocked by Core, and again a right hand, that's got him in trouble. Magee's in big trouble here. Core looking for a finish now. He needs to take a count or he'll be stopped. It's all over. And referee Paul Thomas falls as well. Magee on the floor. It's all over. Maurice Core is the new British light heavyweight champion. Stops Noel Magee in 9 rounds. What a finish. Well, that almost made up for what went before it. And poor old Noel Magee still on the floor. And the ring has been invaded. So the new British light heavyweight champion, that's the 3rd champion. Phil Martin has, Frank Grant did it last Wednesday, Carl Thompson did it earlier in the year. Now Maurice Core is the light heavyweight champion of Great Britain. And here's the finish. And it's the right hand there that started it all off, and possibly Noel would have been better off going down for a count. But Core reined in the punches. Just kept them coming. And referee Paul Thomas really had no choice but to step in then. And those words must sound so sweet to Maurice Core. He is the new light heavyweight champion of Great Britain. And the belt will be presented by Dennis Lockton, an administrative steward of the Boxing Board of Control.
It's a fantastic time for the gym. You know, there was the 5 British champions at the time.
Yeah, it was great. At the time in the gym, everyone was buzzing in the gym, you know. It's like the champion thing is going to go on endlessly, you know. Everyone was due to fight for British titles. When I got my title there, best thing that happened to me in my life, you know, because it's from the amateurs when, you know, I got beaten in the ABA finals, which is probably the best British thing you can get to in standards of ABAs. You know, when I got beat in the other fights, I got beat 5 times in amateurs, out of 65, I think. You know, and I got ripped off in a couple of them, you know. I say to a few of them, I definitely got beat, but I got ripped off. And so he put all that to rest, you know. And now British champion, and I'm number one.
Sweet.
Yeah, it's the best feeling ever. Saying you got a lot of friends out of a sudden anyway.
It was great for the area as well, wasn't it, you know, to have that status, you know, for the gym. And Phil had done remarkable things, you know, not for the lads, but for the area.
Yeah, Phil was there, the icon, and everyone looked up to Phil. The one thing Phil had in here was, like, he was a boss, and he didn't play around with Phil at all. He didn't play, you know, what he said, he done. And they were saying, you know, all you had to do was turn up to the gym and train, listen to what Phil says. And he won the fight, and that's how easy it was. We never had to worry about diets or anything until that. Phil would do everything for you, every little thing. He'd worry for you, everything, you know.
How did your life change when you became British champion?
Like I said, you know, you got a lot of friends all of a sudden. Loads of friends. As far as you're the man now, so you look at life completely different in the boxing term. you're looking at what's ahead now, you know, what's ahead in the world rather than just what's in Britain. You feel like your boxing seems to go better, you know, your boxing, you seem to learn things quicker. You know, you think like a champion, and you know, because you're the man, so everyone's trying to get where you are. So you just feel like your career is just taking a sudden leap, you know, where you're learning all the time, but you're learning quick as well, you know, and you're putting it to practice.